Saint Lawrence, Deacon, Martyr, 258, Rome. On August 3, 1820, Sister Emma Rich addressed these words to the pilgrim, "I feel that there is among my relics one of Saint Lawrence. It is just a tiny splinter of bone." The pilgrim hunted in the box of relics and found the small parcel containing two scraps of bone in a brown envelope tied with gold thread. He handed her both. Scarcely had she touched them, when she exclaimed, "One is Stephen's. Oh, what a treasure! This belongs to Lawrence," and, becoming more profoundly absorbed, she continued, "See, there they both stand. Lawrence is behind Stephen. Stephen wears the white robe of a Jewish priest with lappets on the shoulders, and a broad girdle. He is a beautiful youth, taller than Lawrence. Lawrence wears the flowing robe of a deacon." Sister Emmerich's joy at having found this treasure was very great. The vision she beheld seemed so real that, all at once, she exclaimed, "But we have none of their bones. They are still alive. There they are. It is truly laughable. How could I think we had their relics, when they are yet alive?" Later on, she said, "Besides the white priestly robe and broad cincture, Stephen wears on his shoulders a scalloped cape, woven in red and white, and carries a palm branch in his hand. Lawrence appeared in a long plaited robe of bluish white with a wide cincture. He wore a stole around his neck. He was not so tall as Stephen. But he was young, beautiful, fearless like him. His relic must have been scorched by fire. It is wrapped in a scrap of black stuff." The pilgrim here opened the cover, and found the relic just as described. The gridiron Sister Emma Rich continued, had around it like a pan, and in the middle of each side was a handle by which to lift it. It had 6 feet and 4 flat cross bars. When the saint was stretched on it, a bar was placed over him from right to left. When Lawrence appeared to me, the gridiron was near him. On the feast of Saint Lawrence, she related the following, "Ill I saw that Lawrence was a Spaniard, a native of the city of Huesca. His parents were pious Christians, the mother's name Patience, the father's I have forgotten. All the inhabitants were not Christians, and the houses of the latter were marked with a cross cut in stone, of which some had a single, others a double transverse arm. Lawrence had a special devotion to the Blessed Sacrament. When about 11 years old, he was endowed with a supernatural consciousness of its presence, so that he felt its approach even if we were carried concealed. Wherever it was born he followed with liveliest veneration. His pious parents had not so great a devotion themselves, and they blamed his zeal as excessive. I saw him give a touching proof of his love for the Blessed Sacrament. He once saw a priest carrying the Blessed Sacrament secretly to a leprous woman, a most disgusting object, who lived in a miserable hovel near the city wall. Impelled by devotion, Lawrence stealthily followed the priest and prayerfully watched all the ceremonies. Just as the priest laid the sacred host on the poor creature's tongue, she vomited, ejecting the sacred species at the same time. The priest, whose name I knew, was a holy man. He became a saint. But just at this moment, he was perfectly bewildered, not knowing how to withdraw the sacred host from the filth in which it lay. From his hiding place, the boy Lawrence saw all. Unable to control the ardor of his love for Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament, he rushed into the room and, conquering every sentiment of disgust, threw himself on his knees and reverently took up the body of his Lord with his lips. For this heroic self-victory he received from God indomitable strength and fortitude of soul. I saw, also, in an indescribable manner, that Lawrence was not born of the blood nor of the will of man, but of God. He was shown me as a newborn babe, and it was told me that he had been begotten in the spirit of renunciation with sentiments of confusion and penitence. His parents were in the state of grace, having devoutly received Holy Communion. So that, in his very conception, Lawrence had been consecrated to God, thereby receiving as an inheritance his early veneration for the Blessed Sacrament and the consciousness of its presence. I was filled with joy on beholding a child begotten as I have always thought it should be in Christian marriage, a state which ought to be looked upon as one of humiliating penance. Soon after his heroic act, Lawrence with his parents' consent went to Rome. There I saw him visiting the sick and prisoners in company with the holiest priests. He soon became especially dear to Pope Sixtus, who ordained him deacon. Lawrence always served the Pope's Mass. I saw the Pope communicating him under both forms after his own communion, and then Lawrence distributing the sacrament to the Christians. There was no communion table such as we have. But to the right of the altar was a railing with a swinging ledge, behind which the communicants knelt. The deacons generally took turns in administering the sacrament, but Lawrence always discharged that duty for Sixtus. When the latter was led to prison, I saw Lawrence running and calling after him not to leave him behind. Sixtus, divinely inspired, predicted his deacon's approaching martyrdom, and ordered him to distribute the treasures of the church to the poor. Then I saw Lawrence hurrying with a large sum of money in his bosom to the widow Syriaca, with whom were concealed numbers of Christians and sick people. He humbly washed the feet of all. Relieved by the imposition of hands, the widow, who had long suffered from violent headache, healed the lame, the sick, the blind, and distributed alms. Syriaca aided him in every way, especially in converting the sacred vessels into money. That night I saw him entering a vault, penetrating deep into the catacombs, giving alms and other relief, distributing the sacrament, and inspiring all with extraordinary courage. He was radiant with joy, full of supernatural fortitude and earnestness. Then I saw him with Syriaca hastening to the Pope's prison. As the latter was led forth to death, Lawrence told him that he had distributed the treasure, and that he was now ready to follow him to death as his deacon. The Pope again foretold his martyrdom, and Lawrence was arrested on the spot by the soldiers, who had heard him speaking of treasures. Sister Emmerich here saw every detail of St. Lawrence's imprisonment and martyrdom, just as related in the legend of the former and the acts of the latter. She saw also the cures he wrought in prison, the conversion of Romain and Hippolytus, etc. She says, Lawrence's tortures were long. They were continued all night with uncommon cruelty. Between two courtyards used as places of execution, ran a colonnade in which were kept the instruments of torture and in which all the preparations for the same were made. It was thrown open to spectators, and here Lawrence was stretched on the gridiron. Strengthened by his angel, he stepped lightly toward it with a gay remark, and laid himself upon it, refusing, however, to allow himself to be bound. I felt that, by divine assistance, he was insensible to the greater part of his torments. He lay as if upon roses. Other martyrs have had more terrible sufferings to endure. He wore the white robe of a deacon, a girdle, a stole, a scalloped cape, and a kind of upper garment like Stephen's. I saw him buried by Hippolytus and the priest Justin. Many wept over his grave and mass was said there. Lawrence once appeared to me when I had scruples about receiving Holy Communion. He questioned me upon the state of my soul. When I had answered him, he said that I might communicate every other day. Amen.